God has a plan, and he uses different members of his body to do different things in his plan. And I can get behind any member of the body of Christ that's actually fulfilling the will of God. Even though that may not be what I'm doing, I realize that they're doing it, and it's anointed, and it's appointed, and it's fruitful. But I don't want to just do that because I see them being successful. I want to do what God's called me to do and be successful at that. And if it seems small in somebody's eyes, that doesn't bother me a bit. That doesn't bother me one bit. Amen. If there's a little community where they've got 10 people and they need a pastor and everybody's praying, I want a pastor of 5,000. I've been around those people. That'd be that would be their confession. They'd confess it every Sunday over the church. They'd have everybody join in. I've been there. Susan, I've been there. Have everybody join in. We're a church of 5,000. Everybody confess that. We're a church of 5,000. They'd confess it. Because confession brings possession. We're a church of 5,000. Another minister I met, he was a church of 10,000. Another minister. Can I tell you a quick little story? I was preaching in this church one time. Susan's going to sit down. I was doing a week revival, a week of meetings, you know, stir up the gift. Sometimes people need to get stirred up. You're already born again, but sometimes people need to get stirred up. Revival has more than one definition. You're not dead. You revive the dead. Christians aren't dead, but they do need to get stirred up sometimes. Amen. So I was in this revival, and one of the messages that I preached was three steps to unshakable faith. I've got it in a book, but before I had it in a book, I was preaching it. Still am, still preaching it. Three steps to unshakable faith. Come to Jesus, hear his sayings, and do them. If you'll come to Jesus, hear his sayings, and do them, then the storm comes, and it comes. You'll never avoid the storm. Even in Psalm 91, when it says that no plague comes nigh my dwelling. No plague comes nigh my dwelling. That doesn't mean it won't try. What it does mean is when it does try, it won't have the same effect that it has on other people. Like Susan and I had COVID-19 for 2.5 days. 2.5 days. So it tried. But because of our stand and our walk, and then we teach this, because not everybody has the same success rate, and that's why you keep teaching and encouraging people. Because it'll work if you'll stay built up and stay encouraged. It'll work. But it comes, it tries, but it doesn't have the same effect that it would on the world. And so the storm comes, the stream beats, the flood rises. That's in Luke chapter 6. The storm comes, the stream beats, the flood rises. But Jesus said, can't shake him. Can't shake him. Well, I was teaching that in this church. Three steps to unshakable faith. Cannot shake you when you come to Jesus, hear his sayings, and you do them. What comes against you will not finish its design, its plan. It won't finish. It won't be the way that the world would be. It comes to destroy you, or it comes to maybe do a two-week thing or a three-week thing or a four, you know, but it won't have the same effect on you. If you come to Jesus, hear his sayings, and you do them, which is where most people miss it. They don't do it. And that's what Jesus said, he that cometh to me and heareth my sayings, and he doesn't do them. So that's where most people miss it. I want to hear the word. Well, that's not enough. I've come to hear the word. Well, I'm glad, but that's not enough. And most people don't do it. That's why they don't have success, is they don't do it. Well, I was preaching that in this church. And after the service was over, the pastor came up to me and he said, Brother Tony, if we had faith like we're supposed to have faith, we wouldn't have any problems. And I immediately thought, where have you been for the last hour? Because that's not anything anywhere near what I just taught. I just taught that you will have problems. But now it's what you do about it that will determine the outcome. Brother, and this is the pastor. It's a good church, a good, thriving, growing church. I guess maybe they had 100 people at the time and growing. He said, Brother Tony, if we had faith the way we're supposed to, we wouldn't have any problems. And I immediately wondered, where have you been the last hour? Did you not hear anything that I just said, showing you from the Bible? This is what Jesus said. This isn't my opinion. I gave you scripture. Where have you been for the last hour? This isn't just my opinion on the matter. I just gave you scripture for the last hour. Where have you been? And then I said, well, what about Paul? Paul had some challenges, didn't he? Now, what's the difference? It didn't finish its work. The design was to kill him. The design was to stop him. Wasn't that right? Didn't he have some opportunities? Wasn't he persecuted? But the design was to kill him. The design was to stop him. Did it stop him? Did it kill him? I mean, even when it did, he didn't stay dead. The saints gathered around him and lifted him up, raised him up. He was left for dead in Lystra. It says they left him for dead. Somebody said it doesn't say he was dead. Well, all right, fine. You can mince words. But the saints gathered around him. So the design of the devil didn't finish its work, even though he was attacked. It didn't finish. And that's what Jesus said. The storm will come, but it won't shake you. He'd just get back up and go back to preaching. That's why we ought to stay with it. Even when persecution comes, just stay with it. Amen. Don't quit. The only one that wins then is the devil. That's right. Amen. Well, it's hard. Well, Jesus didn't say it would never be hard. But the Bible does say endure hardness as a good soldier. Amen. So I said to him, this is the pastor I'm talking to in this church. Thriving, good, full of life church, growing. I said, what about Paul? He said this to me. He said, oh, Paul didn't know what we know. Pastor, Paul didn't know what we know. I heard a voice on the inside of me. He's losing his ministry and doesn't know it. I said, that startled me. Pastor might have thought what he said startled me, but it's what I heard on the inside startled me. He's losing his ministry and doesn't know it. That's the way it sounded to me. He's losing his ministry and doesn't know it. On the inside, I said, why are you telling me that? You want me to tell him? Seems to me you ought to tell him. And I heard just a quieter voice. No, he won't listen. I just want you to watch him. Well, I did over the matter of months. He lost that, went to another smaller place. He lost that, went to another place. Then he's living meeting in somebody's home with just a small Bible study. His wife left him. His family left him. Finally, he quit the ministry entirely and started selling insurance. Not anything wrong with selling insurance, but he's got a call of God on him. And somebody told me they saw him in a bar smoking a cigarette and drinking a beer, just living the way the world lives. Just living the way the world lives. Well, he's losing his ministry and doesn't know it. Well, what are you telling me that? You want me to tell him? No, he won't listen. Just watch. I never told him. I never told him. What, and even to this day, I've never told him. And we've seen him. Because he's still, I guess, in the area. I haven't seen him in a long time. But never told him to this day. Because the Lord told me not to tell him. Just watch him. Now, I said all of that to say this. This is the same minister. At the beginning of those meetings, because I'm there for about a week, I think, but several days. At the beginning of those meetings, he came in and he said, Brother Tony, we've picked out the land. We're going to build a 10,000-seat cathedral and be in it by May. And I think this was February or March. February. We've picked out the land. We're going to build a 10,000-seat cathedral and be in it by May. Now, he had about 100 people. What's he need a 10,000-seat cathedral for? Well, I asked him some more questions. I said, you picked out the land? You've got a deposit? No. You put any money down on it? No. Well, what do you mean you picked out the land? Well, I saw the for sale sign riding down the road, and I just pointed to it and claimed it in Jesus' name. I said, that's all you did. You hadn't made an offer. You hadn't put any money down, no deposit. You've just pointed to it and claimed it in Jesus' name. Yeah, that's all I did. Because if you confess it, you know, confession brings possession. And we've been there when they would every Sunday have the whole congregation. This is a church of 5,000. How'd I get on that anyway? Amen. But what we want to do is follow the Lord. Yes. Follow the Lord. And so there are some that might be called in that area. But how I got on it was, what about that group that's got 10 people? They are needing a shepherd. They're needing a pastor. And everybody is saying, no, I want to be a pastor of 5,000 people. You mean God's not going to send anybody to that group? And if God does send somebody to that group, everybody else is going to try to intimidate them to be different than they are. Well, you're not even using your faith because you know there ought to be 50 people. You know there ought to be 100 people. Why don't you use your faith? Well, God cares for these 10 people, and that's where I'm using my faith. God cares for these 10 people, and that's where I'm using my faith. You use your faith where God's called you. I'm using my faith here. And we ought to just hook in and encourage people to do what God's called them to do instead of trying to shape them to be something that God didn't call them to be. I just want to encourage people, you obey God. Amen. Do what God's called you to do. But make sure God's called you to do it. You get out there on your own, and you'll be like that guy. Now, while he had that group of 100, he's doing pretty good. He felt like he was in high cotton. And in the area, other ministers referred to him as knowing something about the things of faith and the things of God because he had what looked like success. You better not go by that. Don't go by what looks like success in anybody's eyes. It doesn't matter if they think it's successful or not. You stay in your prayer closet. It doesn't matter if anybody says it's successful or anybody says it's not successful. You stay in your prayer closet. And don't you even go by what you see. You stay in your prayer closet and fulfill the will of God for you. And if God wants you to be a pastor of 5,000 or a minister that's preaching to tens of thousands, then obey that. But if God just uses you to be on a Zoom meeting to a few dozen people around the world, then do that and be faithful. Whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might and be faithful. Be faithful. And when you're rewarded, you'll be rewarded not because of your what looked like success, but you'll be rewarded for your faithfulness. God rewards faithfulness.
Yes, he does.
God rewards faithfulness. It's not achievement per se. It's faithfulness. That's what God rewards. And along with the rewards of faithfulness that are coming in heaven, because there are rewards for us in heaven, you'll have some blessings on this earth. You'll have some blessings. That's one reason the things of God, the Word of God, and the Spirit of God will work for you, is because you're in communication, in conjunction with, in fellowship with the Holy Spirit. And your heart doesn't condemn you. You have confidence, and then you receive His blessings. If your heart doesn't condemn you, you have confidence, and then whatever you ask, you receive. And your faith will work, and you'll walk in blessings because you're fulfilling the will of God for you in your life. And sometimes people are called of God to hook in with somebody else. That's your call. That's your call. Moses needed Aaron and Hur. That was their call. Aaron never was the leader of the children of Israel. Can somebody say amen? I mean, Aaron, if he was like some people I know, he would have bellyached and complained when Joshua was appointed. That's not fair. I'm the one that served Moses for all these years. He couldn't even talk right. I'm the one. And then who's the one that leads the children of Israel in Joshua? That's not right. I'm glad God didn't ask that committee. Amen. And so Aaron was called of God just to serve Moses. That's his call. Aaron and Hur. That's their call. And they'll be rewarded for being faithful. It's not the achievement, it's the faithfulness. That's their call. That's what I'm called to do, is to hold his coat while he preaches. That's what I'm called to do. Well, somebody needs to hold the coat. And I know my heart, I'd just soon be the one holding the coat. The Lord knows that. I've told him that any number of times. I'd just be just as happy to hold somebody else's coat. And I certainly have. I did that for a number of years. But I'd be just happy doing that again. Can somebody say amen? So, we're members in particular. And the members of the body have a purpose. And when one's honored, we all rejoice. When one's hurting, we all are concerned. That's how the body ought to work together. When one member of the body is hurting, all of the body is interested. When one member of the body is honored, all of the body is going to rejoice, because we're in the body of Christ. And Jesus is the one that we are praising. Jesus is the one that we glorify. He receives the glory. Anything that's done in his body, he receives the glory. Anything done in the body of Christ, Jesus receives the glory. Can somebody say amen? Praise God forever.